Prof, it's a pleasure having you on Sahara TV again.
Thank you.
This is Professor Sylvester Odunakaini, the Department of Political Science, Lagos State University. Yesterday, the Nigerian National Assembly, the Senate, actually passed the Electoral Act amendment, and amidst rancor and lots of disagreement within the House, let me first of all get your reactions, especially with regards to the issues that became, you know, core issue of dispute, and that has to do with the electronic transmission of results. Why does it have to be a controversial issue?
Well, I think that the controversy about electronic transmission of results can only be understood within the context of the fact that we have had, you know, a long history of electoral, you know, matters. Elections have not been free and fair in this country, you know, if you review the electoral history. Of course, if you remember very well, in 1983, when the Nigerian Second Republic was truncated by the military, part of the reason they gave was essentially that, look, the election of 1983, you know, was anything but free and fair. And I think the incumbent president was the leader of the coup at that time, you know, used that statement in his broadcast, that it was anything but free and fair. Now, so we have been searching for methods, you know, measures that can ensure the integrity of the electoral process in Nigeria. And I think that, you know, we are fortunate that the internet communication, you know, technology, you know, has come to enable that process. And countries have adopted it in ways that, you know, the electoral process has become very transparent, you know, and highly regarded in terms of integrity. You know, I think that Nigerians are so desirous of that. Because if you look at the contradictions of the electoral process in our country, ballot matching, you know, is one of them. Manipulation of results at the collation center. And these are issues that have cast what I would call slur on the electoral process. You know, to the extent that the outcome of elections in terms of those who are actually elected cannot be said to be legitimately representing, you know, the interest of Nigerians.
Now, let's look at part of the reasons why the National Assembly actually took that decision with regards to eventually, I mean, giving powers to the National Assembly, to the NCC, that's the Nigerian Communication, and as well as INEC, to determine where electronic transmission of results will be. Do you agree with the sentiments of the majority in the Senate?
I think that we need to be a bit critical about, you know, the adoption of electronic transmission of results. You know, I mean, the only thing that people will always point to, ICT expert will tell you, is the fear of, you know, cyber attacks.
That's okay.
You know, so what can we do to, of course, ensure that it doesn't occur? But I also think that beyond, you know, the fear of cyber attack, results that are transmitted right from walls are already captured by, you know, observers, polling agents, party agents who are present, you know, at that you know, location. So the question about cyber attack and alteration of what has been transmitted electronically can be backed up by the evidence, you know, of all the actors present at the polling booth, or the ward where those results are being, you know, transmitted at the end of the day. But I think the point to make is that the advantage or the advantages of electronic transmission is far, you know, they are far, you know, better, you know, higher than the disadvantages, if there are, you know, such as cyber attack that we just pointed out, you know. But I think overall, Nigeria will see a situation whereby their own votes begin to, you know, attain some significance. And many, because it will not be possible for people to rig elections. And I think that what Marita from the Senate section yesterday, if you ask me, is that, you know, there are those we call stamp patters who are enamored of the status quo, who believe that they cannot win a free and fair election, you know, who are standing against electronic transmission, you know. But where the House of Reps is here to take a position on that, maybe we can be hopeful, you know, that we can go beyond, you know, the conditional approval of that process by the Senate, you know, with regard to electronic transmission.
Now, the Senate president had earlier stated, that's President Senator, I mean, Senator Ahmed Lawan, that he described as a calculated blackmail against the leadership of the National Assembly, that those accusing the National Assembly of tampering with the Electoral Act Amendment report are just rabble-rousers, mischievous and misinformed. I mean, considering what played out eventually yesterday, what Nigerians right to have called them out?
I think Nigerians are right. We must be very frank, you know, that democracy has not become the only game in town, particularly with regard to the present actors in Nigeria. They don't play by the rules, you know, and of course most of the things they do is to the extent that it can't foster, you know, self-aggrandizement on their part. And so Nigerians are right. Nigerians who desire electronic transmission of results want Nigeria's democracy to be consolidated. And I think that is the point, because if elections are not free and fair, then the stability of the polity is also in question at the end of the day. So Nigerians are right. I mean, if a clause was smuggled in, you know, that says that it should not be electronically transferred, of course, that has again be subject to further amendment, you know, as a result of that controversy, you know. So that contestation shows that there were elements who were hell-bent on subverting, you know, that process. But let's hope that since you need the concurrence of the two houses, you know, that the House of Reps can sway, you know, the bill in ways that the original content, you know, in terms of unconditional transfer of transmission of results, will prevail at the end of the day.
Now, let me get your view, sir, on the assessment of this ninth National Assembly. A lot of Nigerians, so to say, have not reposed much confidence in the ability of this National Assembly to actually perform its constitutional role with respect to checks and balances. Let me seek your reaction. What is your assessment of this ninth National Assembly with regards to, I mean, its constitutional role and responsibility of serving as checks and balances? And with regards to this electoral amendment, can Nigeria actually repose any kind of confidence or integrity on this ninth National Assembly?
I think that the point to make is that Nigerians will soon heave a sigh of relief, because the ninth assembly will be over in a matter of few years. That is the point. But generally speaking, the Nigerian parliament, since the inception of the Fourth Republic, has not been exceptional. You know, has not been. But of course, there are a few incidents, such as the defeat of the third term, you know, ambition of General Olusegun Obasanjo. You know, that was, you know, quite remarkable, and the rest of them, despite the financial endorsement, you know, of that process. But they were still able to stand to defeat that quest for a third term. You know, but generally speaking, what we have in Nigeria since 1999 has been what the British call long parliament, a subservient, you know, parliament that is controlled by the executive. That's basically what we have had. But I think what is unique about the ninth assembly is that right from day one, when the house officials were elected, it was clear that, you know, this was going to be a rubber stamp, you know, assembly. And that is basically what has played out. The speed with which they approve all kinds of loans for the executive, to the extent that the country is heavily indebted and a sizable percentage of our national income is used for debt servicing, you know. And again, when you have progressive policies that are about to be mainstream into the polity to stabilize the polity, and these elements within the National Assembly will go against it, shows that it is nothing other than a rubber stamp, you know, parliament.
That's you mentioned the issue of the loans that this National Assembly has actually churned out for this executive. Nigerians are worried and they're concerned about the repayment and the economic impact and the multiplier effect of these loans. What's your view of this stance of Nigerians with regards to the future of the economy of this country?
Nigerians are right to express, you know, their disappointment and apprehension. The point is very clear. When we got out of the debt loop under Obasanjo regime, you know, I remember very well the broadcast President Obasanjo made on that day to say that Nigeria has just gotten its second independence. It meant that Nigeria was going to have a very plain, you know, policy environment to chart its own economic policy without being dictated to. Once you become a debtor nation, you lose your sovereignty. You know, what you have is negative sovereignty, to the extent that your creditors can dictate policies, you know, to you. And I think that Nigeria is ought to be an important, such an important country in Africa, you know, that should exercise independent policy. You know, but what we have done is to put ourselves in the loop. So, in which case, it will be very difficult for us to exercise, you know, independent policy. Because the way we are today, Nigeria is going to be borrowing even to service the indebtedness. And the state elite, unfortunate for the country, the state players are not disciplined enough to be able to bail the country out. And don't forget that the fossil fuel, which is the source of income for the country, is also, you know, no longer attractive internationally. So I do not know how we are going to bail ourselves out of it, but maybe perhaps some magic, you know, will happen, and Nigeria may be able to get out of the debt loop. But within the realm of practicality and the foreseeable future, you know, we are going to remain in the loop, in the debt loop, for a long time, you know, to come. Don't forget that it took Nigeria, as at the time we got the Paris debt, bailout or relief. That was 2005/2006. If you look back, that $32 billion that, you know, was outstanding had accumulated all through the Second Republic, and of course back to the first Republic, that we accumulated that debt. So if it took almost over years now, 60, 70, 80, 90, you know, almost like 40 years to get out of it. Then I doubt if we'll be able to get out of it, because I do not see another, you know, windfall in terms of huge resources accrued from sales of fossil fuel, which is the petrol that we have as a major product.
That sounds ominous. And considering the fact that the country is continuing to be plunged into more debt crisis, what should be done? I mean, you stated earlier that this government seems to lack the fiscal discipline to do that. What should be done, or what attention should be given at this point in time to turn these around?
I think that essentially we need fiscal discipline. Fiscal discipline is important. And many Nigerians have pointed the way out. You know, a huge amount of resources is spent on the public expenditure. You know, particularly the remuneration of public officials in the country. So that's definitely one way, you know, to go. You know, so there are so many things we can do. And there are things we can do without in revamping the Nigerian, you know, economy. And therefore, freeing ourselves from the debt loops. Our currency is low, you know, today. So it meant that you are going to be spending more and more with a very weak currency. You are going to be spending more and more on imports in hard currency. So, you know, that will have impact on our current account, you know, balance. to the extent that we might not be able to pay for imports. So that would be a crisis situation, which I think that this government does not even have the capacity to handle.
Sadly. Finally, lawmakers must be pushed to demonstrate patriotism. That is the expectations of Nigerians, and for them to pass a citizen-responsive electoral amendment bill that will enhance efficiency in the electoral process and guarantee a free, fair, credible, and transparent elections. Do you foresee this happening, sir?
Well, it's an expectation. It's an expectation. And the Nigerian lawmakers, have not lived up to that expectation. We can only hope that if they share our vision of the future, and they should act in this direction, such that we can truly say that, democracy has become the only game in town with respect to the Nigerian polity.
Professor Sylvester Odiodo Akinyi, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.